the stability in a system is basically defined, or you can say that the system is stable if a smaller change in input or any of the system parameter or any of the initial conditions must not lead to a larger change in the output. Okay? Means a small change in input or a small change in any parameter of the system or a small change in initial condition, any of the initial condition may not lead to larger change in output of the system. If the smaller change lead to larger change in the output of the system, you can say your system is unstable. Correct? The stability of the system is a very important characteristics of transient part of your system. And you, as a control engineer, seeks to find the values of parameters within a certain boundary, and this boundary is defined by the constraint imposed by the stability conditions. Means, suppose you are having a second order system. A general second order system can be represented as Gs is equal to k omega n square s square plus 2 zeta omega n s plus omega n square. So by saying the parameters of the system, here we can say we are having a parameter. One of the parameter is k, correct? Second parameter available which can be changed or tuned is zeta. Third parameter which can be changed or tuned is omega. So you want to achieve particular specification in the transient part of the system, and you know what are the specification. Means you want to reduce the, maybe you want to reduce the delay time or rise time or maximum overshoot or even speediest error. Means you want certain specification. Okay, you want to meet certain specification by your system, and to meet the certain specification by your system, here we are having three parameters which you can change. Okay, there might be a range of change of k. Means k should be less than or equal to k max or k min. Accordingly, zeta should be zeta max, zeta min, and omega n should be omega, omega n max, omega n min. And these boundary, you can see these are the upper boundary and this is the lower boundary for variation in gain of your system. So these boundaries are basically defined by the stability condition of the system. If you change the value of k beyond k max or beyond k min, your system will become unstable. So we are going to read, or we are going to define what will be the boundary for the given parameters. Okay? Correct? So basically there are the two notions of stability. If an LTI system is follow the two notions which I am going to discuss, then you can say your system is stable. Okay? First of the notion is BIBO stability. Capital B-I-B-O stability. Okay. This BIBO refer to bounded input bounded output. Right? It means to this particular notion, try to seek the answer to the question. If you are going to provide a bounded input to your system, so what will be the output? Whether the output is bounded or it is unbounded. If your system gives bounded output with respect to bounded input, your system will be stable. Accordingly, you can say BIBO stability criteria works under the excited system, or you can say when the input is provided, means input is not equal to zero. Okay? Means it's trying to analyze the stability of the system under given excitation. It is not for a relaxed condition, or it is not for a relaxed system in terms of input. Unexcited system can be in a year. Correct? So bounded input, bounded output. What do you mean by bounded input actually? It's a keyword, right? Bounded input. And bounded input should provide bounded output. By saying that input is bounded, you mean that the value of the input should decrease with time or should decrease to the zero when t tends to infinity. Correct? So accordingly you can say this may be a bounded input. Or even such type of input you can say. These are the example of bounded input. These are bounded inputs. Correct? And if your input is keep on increasing with respect to time when t tends to infinity, okay, then you will say your input is unbounded. So these are the graphs of unbounded input. And these are for bounded. Example can be e to the power minus t or e to the power plus t. Accordingly, correct? So this stability system only says that if input is bounded, the nature of output should also be bounded for your system to be stable. It doesn't imply that if your input is unbounded and if you are getting unbounded output, you can't conclude anything about the stability of the system. It just says bounded input should provide bounded output, then only your system will be stable, otherwise unstable. If it is providing unbounded output with respect to your unbounded input, nothing can be said. Even you can't say that your system is unstable. You are working with bounded input. Correct? Okay. Second notion of stability is asymptotic stability. This is our second notion of stability. Okay? This particular notion of stability try to analyze the system without input. Means it is excitation or input should be zero for this type of stability. Means it is try to analyze the control system or any system with no input or relaxed condition. Means no initial condition and no input condition, and try to see or try to analyze the output when your input tends to zero, or when your input becomes zero, your output should also become zero, or you can say your output should attain equilibrium value after t or t when t tends to zero. Means for zero input, your output should decrease down to zero. Suppose. Sorry? Okay, now. Input should be. What was the case for bounded input, bounded output? Input
should not be zero.
Should not be zero, where input should be present. Okay? No, input is not equal to zero, it is correct. Because in that particular case, in bounded input, bounded output, you have provided input to the system. The input, the nature of the input was bounded in nature. If the bounded input is provided to the system and if you are getting the bounded output, it is well and good, it is a stable system. Means with bounded input, here we are not going to provide any input. Means after, suppose you have provided a pulse as an input, and after certain time, t is equal to t1, your pulse is going to be zero. Correct? So, and here you are going to analyzing your output. Suppose after t is equal to t1. Okay. So after t is equal to t1, your input has become zero. So your output also tends to zero. Because after t is equal to t1, then there is no input. So there is no, then there is no input. That's why I have taken that there is no input. After t is equal to t1, there is no input. So there must not be any output when t tends to 0. Means output should tend to your equilibrium value. And if such things happen, you will say that your system is asymptotically stable. And if it continue to provide some output like this, or anything, even constant value, even when your input has dropped down to 0 after t1, it is giving output for t far, far greater than t1, it is not attained the equilibrium value, you will say that your system is not asymptotically stable, or you can say your system is unstable. Correct? Now this is clear? For an LTI system, is a linear time invariant system, both the notion of the stability, whether it is Debye stability or whether we are talking about asymptotic stability, basically those two notion, the two notion of the stability implies to the same system, implies each other. Means if some system is Debye stable, it cannot be asymptotically unstable. Means if it is Debye stable, it will be asymptotically stable as well. And if it is asymptotically stable, it will be Debye stable. That particular system will be Debye stable also. So we are just going to talk about for LTI system these two systems. And for LTI system, we are going to just talk about stability rather than talking about Debye stable or asymptotic stable, because these two notions applies to each other. Correct? Now coming to non-linear system, if your system is non-linear, though in this particular course we will focus on the linear control system only, but you should remember that for non-linear system, due to occurrence of multiple equilibrium points, your asymptotic stability doesn't imply to your Debye stability, or even in certain cases, even you can't define the term stability as a global stability for non-linear type of system. Right? There is no global stability is defined for non-linear type of system. Why? Because there are multiple equilibrium points in the system. When you read a modern control system in net function, you will come to know about it. Okay. But for this course, it is okay. LTI system, stability means whether it should be asymptotically stable or whether it should be Debye stable, all things are set. Now let us try to analyze this stability of the system mathematically. We have already defined transfer function of the system in polynomial form as this. Hence, we can say GS is equal to CS upon RS, and that I am going to say V0 multiplied by S to the power m plus V1 S to the power m minus 1 plus up to Vn. Do you remember that I am just stopping S to the power m, n of S to the power m plus a1 s to the power n minus 1 plus n. Do remember that there is a correlation for realization, realizable system, means there should be some value of m which should be less than n for realizable system. I have already talked about it when I talked about polynomial form of transfer function. Correct? So m should be less than equal to n. When m is equal to n, it is realizable. When m is less than n, it is strictly realizable. Correct? So this is our polynomial, general polynomial form of a transfer function. So what you can say? Cs will be given by Rs in terms of transform multiplied by Gs. Accordingly, if you will take the inverse Laplace transform of this, you will get Ct will be equal to what? RT, some mathematical operation, Gt. What is this mathematical operation? means I mean to say that multiplication in frequency domain is equal to what in time domain?
Convolution.
Convolution in time domain, exactly. Correct? So if you are going to take inverse Laplace transform of this equation, you will get CT is equal to RT convolution GT, where GT is by definition inverse Laplace transform of your transfer function G. Correct? Okay. So now I am going to define 0 to t g tau, where tau is integration variable. First type of things we have already defined when we are deriving the transfer function. Okay? Transfer function from convolution. Okay. So g tau r t minus tau d tau. This is the convolution. You can represent this asterisk sign as this operator. Correct? Where tau is integration variable. We have also changed the limit of t to that of infinity. You might have any number. Okay. So this can be equivalently represented like 0 to infinity z tau r t minus tau d. Correct? Yeah. If you are unable to understand how you have changed this limit, you can refer the lecture on transfer function. Correct? Now, what you are going to see? This is your C. This is your output C. Correct? What you will do after this? You will take the absolute value both sides. Correct? So taking the absolute value both sides to this equation, you can name any number. You can say this is equation number 1. So taking absolute value both sides of your equation number 1, what you will get? You will get mod of Ct will be equal to integration 0 to infinity is mod outside the integration z tau r t minus tau d tau. This is your mod. Correct? And I am going to say this particular mod of integration will be less than integration of modulus of a function. Means I am going to denote this like this. Z tau r t minus tau mod d tau. Whether I can write like this or not, means you have integrated cos and then taken the modulus value. So this will be less than this is less than the case when you are taking the modulus value of the function first and then you are taking integration. If you try to recall your class 12 mathematics, integral mathematics, you might have remembered that integration is nothing but area under curve. Suppose it is very symmetrical curve. I am going to say it is very symmetrical curve. This particular function represents a symmetrical curve. It may be a curve, whatever it may be, but for the time being, I am going to say this particular integrand of this your system is representing a very symmetrical curve. So what will be the integration? Integration, I am going to say this is plus a, and here downside I am going to say this is minus a, because area under curve with sine of. So say this is plus a minus a will be equal to 0, mod of 0 is equal to 0. Correct? And in this particular case, what you are going to do? You are first going to perform the, or for, you are first going to take the absolute value of your integrand. So what you get? You will get like this. Means this will get here. Like this. So this is the area plus a. This is plus a. So value of I will be plus a will be equal to 2a. So you, I think you are wise enough that you will say that 0 is less than 2. Right? So I can say this particular mod of integration will be less than this particular. or you also know from your complex number, even for the knowledge of your absolute value, this particular value will be less than, you can say, 0 to infinity, means C tau or T minus. Correct? Means I am applying this one. X1, X2 mod is less than X1 mod and X2. Class 12 basic mathematics. Correct? So finally you can see CT. Okay. Your output CT, modulus of your output CT should be less than equal to 0 to infinity g tau modulus of r t minus tau d tau. Correct? I am going to say this. If you have named the previous equation as equation 1, then you can name it as equation 2. I have not named that particular equation, so I am going to say this is equation 1 for me. For you, it can be equation 1. See carefully. I have said under Bimbo stability that your system should provide bounded output when your input is bounded. Means I am going to perform an experiment where I am going to take bounded input itself. I am not going to take bounded, unbounded input. So bounded input means this value, this absolute value should be any finite value. Correct? So you can say mod of CT should be less than equal to, I am going to name it as a constant M1, maximum value M1. Okay? By bounded means I am going to say mod of RT should be less than M1, that is less than infinity. What is the meaning of saying that your input is bounded? Mathematically, a bounded input can be represented like this. By saying that our input RT is bounded, I can say its maximum value is any maximum value is any constant M1, and that M1 should not be equal to infinite. Then it is bounded. Correct? So I am going to take the maximum value. So accordingly, here you can also take, apply this. This will be less than this one. So you can say this overall integration will be less than M1. You are going to take outside this G tau D tau. 0 to infinity. Correct or not? Means this, you can say this is less than this one. Means you can say like this. This is less than equal to this one. M1, 0 to infinity, G tau D tau. Correct? This I am going to say. And from this, I am going to say this. Correct? Any doubt? If you are having any doubt, you can ask. So I have said I have taken the input is bounded, I have taken the maximum value. This value should be less than the maximum of this. Means if your input is bounded, this is nothing but the shifted input. The shifted value in the time domain. Since your input is bounded, the shifted value will also be bounded. So no problem. So this value will be less than the maximum of this value. So less than this value, maximum of this value is M1, which is not infinite. So you can directly say this mod of CT is less than this. And if your output has to be bounded, what it should be? It should be less than equal to some constant M2, which should be less than infinity. If such integration is possible, means if you are able to find such value of this integrand, a constant value for this relation is satisfied, means you are able to get the maximum value M2, which is not infinity, then you can say your system is Bimbo stable. Correct? Okay? Or in other words, you can say your output will be bounded for a bounded input when your this absolute integration is bounded, correct? And this absolute integration is of nothing but this is related to your what? Transfer function of the system. This is Gto is what? Or Gt is what? Laplace inverse of the transfer function of the system. So you can say your Vivo stability, or in general you can say the stability of an LTI system, is going to depend one and only on the behavior of the transfer function of the system. Because how you are going to go, whatever the value of your transfer function, accordingly the inverse Laplace will change, and it is going to define whether this absolute integration is finite or not. So all in all, you can say the stability of the system is defined by the transfer function of the system, or again you can say this also defined by the roots of the system, or you can say this is also defined by the zeros of the characteristic equation. The zeros of the characteristic equation is nothing but when you will put the denominator polynomial is equal to zero, that will become the zeros of the characteristic equation, or you can say this particular equation means for total transfer function we have taken Gs upon 1 plus GsHs, correct? So this is your characteristic equation, and when 1 plus GsHs is become 0, so this value of S we are going to find out will going to define overall characteristic or overall behavior of your system at hand, correct? And that's why these equations are known as characteristic equation, because these are characteristic to the given system. Okay. Well, so we have just established the fact that the stability of a system is going to depend on one and only on the transfer function, and this transfer function is going to depend on the characteristic equation. So all in all you can say the stability of the system is defined by the zeros of the characteristic equation, or equivalently you can say the poles of your transfer function. So we are going to see the location of pole, and we are going to find how your system is how the response of your system, correct? So first case is a single root. First case is that single root means root of what? Root of transfer function. Single root at S is equal to sigma. Sigma may be any value, may be plus, plus or minus, may be any value. You remember that this your S plane is somewhat like this. Your S plane. You represent real quantity as a sigma and imaginary quantity as a sigma. So sigma may be this side of it. May be plus 2 or minus 2 or anything. So I am going to take the roots, there is only roots in your system, and that is located at S is equal to sigma. So the general response to the first type of system will be given by A into e to the power sigma t. Correct? This response has obtained by providing impulse input to the system. That's why I am saying impulse response to the system, nature of impulse response. Why I have provided an impulse response only? Because the definition of transfer function is correlated to the impulse response. Okay? So if you are having single root S is equal to at S is equal to sigma, you will get A e to the power sigma. For example, you can take example. Okay. If you are having transfer function at GS is equal to 1 S 1 divided by S plus 9. It is possible. Here the value of sigma is, if the value of sigma is 2, minus 2 or plus 2, correct? So I am going to take this. When S is equal to, j omega and S sigma, where sigma is equal to minus 2, correct? So S will be equal to minus 2. Here, equivalently, for positive sigma, you can have omega sigma Then you can say S is equal to this is the place where technical festival happen like this. This is the only place I have ever seen. Okay? Highly non-technical in nature. Okay. People are enjoying outside sometimes, cover the game sometimes, go go and sometimes. That's a basket version. Less emphasis on the technical. Okay. So, here, your root is on the left side of the S-plane. I will summarize this, but for the time being, there is a single root which is left side, and in this particular case, there is one and only root present in GS, that is on the right side of the root. That's what I have to put this value, what you will get. In this particular case, you will get the value of A is equal to 1, sigma is equal to minus 2. So, e to the power
minus
2. So, how your response will be? It will start from 1, it will decay with time. Correct? It is C. And in this particular case, what will happen? Impulse response to the system will look like more like this. This will start at 1, you can say, and it will keep on increasing. So just by saying, can you say which of the system may fall under this error category?
S equal to minus 2.
Yes. Okay. Correct. Now, take a second case. Second case is that you are having complex conjugate rules. General response to the system. If a system is having a complex pair, and if you are going to provide impulse as an input, you will get an output which will be given by this equation. Correct? So for first case, then you can say envelope is there. We have already seen. Envelope is there. So when sigma, value of sigma will be negative, it will be like this. Envelope will decay with time and your response accordingly will also decay. Correct? What will happen to the second case? This is your time axis, this is your time axis, this is nothing but your CT. Correct? In this particular case, when the sigma is positive, so your roots will lie on the right half plane, correct? So your response, pulse response will be given by this. So which one seems to be the stable? This one or this one?
So when sigma is negative.
Sigma was negative. In the first case also we have seen, when sigma was negative, whenever there was single root, in that case also when sigma was negative, the system response was bounded, or you can say your system was stable. In second case also, when sigma is negative, response is bounded, you can say your system is stable. So we will see or we will summarize these things. But before that, we are going to take third case. We are going to do it first. Third case is that single complex conjugate root pairs on G omega axis. This type of analysis will help you to solve objective questions directly without any calculation. Single complex conjugate root pair on J omega axis, and J omega axis is your imaginary axis. Can you guess what you have to? What may happen? If you I'm going to say that here it is, roots are here. A single pair on G omega axis. So this will lead to a sinusoidal output of constant amplitude, you can say. Why? Because when sigma was less than 0, your amplitude was decreasing in nature. When sigma was greater than 0, your response was increasing in nature. When they are just at G omega axis, there will be oscillation of constant amplitude. Right? So what does it mean? It means that this particular J omega axis is going to play a permanent role in stability analysis. Correct? We will take some more examples also. Case number 4. Case number 4. For double pairs of roots. Now we are having 4 roots and they are repeated on one another. Means one more root is present here. And here means the pair is such that the value is same. Correct? So for first type of case, without showing you mathematically, you can take example, okay, and solve it at your home. I am just going to show you that the nature of response is like this. Conditional stability. when your rows are not repeated, you can say your system is marginally stable. Okay, and when your rows are repeated on j omega axis, then you can say your system is unstable. Correct? Okay. Now take the fifth case, single rooted origin.